Episode 66, sponsored by valleywideglass.com. Thank you, Kevin, for sponsoring the pod. Our guest today is Augusto Tiquinho Mendez.
Go!
He is IBJJF Black Belt Gi World Champion, two-time No-Gi World Champion, two-time World Pro Champion, ADCC Champion, fought in the UFC, beat guys like Rafa Mendez, beat Cobrinha, pretty much the biggest names in Jiu-Jitsu. Tiquinho's got wins over. And if you talk to a lot of people will say he's one of the greatest of all time, so it's pretty badass. And he's our professor coming in for the pod.
Thank you.
What'd you think of the studio?
Man, like, first thought that I had was like, fuck, that's small here. Like, when the camera looks bigger.
Everyone says that. Yeah, it's just a little extra room.
Yeah, but it's nice. A nice setup, you know.
Fuck yeah. How's your body feeling? Good?
Feel good. Just getting back to train again, getting shape again. You know what I mean? Being lazy.
Yeah.
And
shit, you know, being lazy. You've been doing dad duties.
I have a new baby, and also, like, any time that I have a off, I try to sleep. You know, that's it.
I was thinking about it. I was like, imagine if you'd have took that fight in Poland or wherever it was at. And imagine if you'd have had to get surgery or something and go through this with the new baby and Amanda
impossible.
With the surgery out.
No, impossible.
Oh, that would have been bad.
And like later, I found that like it was impossible to me to go to Russia. The fight was in Russia because I had my citizenship ceremony. And then when you like was like 10 days before the fight, right? When you go to your ceremony, you need to give back your green card. So I couldn't leave the United States until I get the American passport.
Fuck.
And that's take like 6 weeks.
When did you find that out?
When I was in the ceremony.
Damn.
Well, that's good that
yeah, like I think it would mean me to be, you know what I mean? To not be on that fight and...
Yeah, it worked out good. Yeah. So how old were you? You've been doing jiu-jitsu now for how many years?
23.
23 years doing jiu-jitsu. So how old were you?
What's your age?
Since I was two.
Dang.
That's crazy.
So how old were you when you started?
I was 14. 13 and like 3 months to become 14.
So and just randomly stumbled by a jiu-jitsu academy or?
No, my brother was training before. He was training for almost a year. And I was trying to be a soccer player in Brazil. You know what I mean? I love soccer. I used to love more, but that was doing Brazil when I was younger, like trying to play soccer and go to the clubs, the tests, this and that. And my brother was doing jiu-jitsu, and every night he was coming back home and tried to convince me to go to train. Hey, let's train. It's fun. And I said, fuck no, I don't want that. I don't want to be grappling
man.
Guys
and shit.
You know what I mean? No, fuck no. And then one day he eventually said, man, go there, just watch. And they went. I thought it was fun. And then I tried and fuck.
With a gi?
With a gi, yeah. Man, I think I just started training no gi. Probably I was like purple belt.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
damn.
Probably. Before
that's
that,
sweet.
Yeah, before that was just gi.
That's cool.
I was all
because
the time gi.
In Brazil, there's probably a jiu-jitsu academy on every single block, probably, huh?
Yes. It's not like here. Well, we have like 5 miles, 10 miles distance. But there's like 5 minutes walk. You know what I mean? Like to each other, like sometimes 10 minutes. And
do they have jiu-jitsu in high school or no?
No.
They don't?
God, I wonder when that's going to happen. Probably soon.
I wonder.
I don't know. Like jiu-jitsu is kind of like expensive in Brazil too. You know what I mean? I think it's everywhere. It's not cheaper sport.
Yeah.
You know, like you need to buy the gi, pay the memberships, tournaments. And so it's not... And a lot of... In Brazil, a lot of poor people, you know. So it is hard to maintain that. And... Like, I'm glad that my parents let me do it for when I was, like, younger. And then, soon I started to have results. We got, like, a discount on the academy. They let us train for free, so it's good. But
so, when did you start, like, getting results? And when did you decide, like, okay, jiu-jitsu is going to be my life?
I think it was like 16, 17.
So 2 years in?
Yeah, like...
Damn.
Because I won the Worlds as a 17 years old, blue belt.
That's fucking sweet.
And then, like right there, I knew it. That's what I want. I wanted to like keep doing that. I was already like teaching, you know what I mean? Not the main instructor, but I was helping the black belt. Then also I was having fun, you know what I mean? I was not thinking about the money because I was not making money teaching, you know what I mean? I was making something like you're making here, $20 a month. That's it. Pretty much, that was making that. So I was not even counting, you know what I mean? I was going there just having fun, helping and learning more and having fun with my progress, you know? And then, like I said, 16, 17, when I started to be blue belt, and then start to see the level of the guys. It was not. It was different when I was fighting as a yellow belt. Yellow belt is like, you kids have tough guys, but like blue belt, you start to see like the worlds and any other, the level of the competition started to go higher and higher. And say, oh, fuck, yeah, I want to do that. You know what I mean?
And you always had supportive parents? Your parents always supported
you?
Yeah,
my parents always like in the beginning, my mom went to the tournaments, watch and sit the drivers there, but like after a while, she said, no, do whatever you want, you know what I mean? Like, she was supporting when you went back home, say, hey, how'd that go? How was good? I lost, so I won.
It's hard to watch jiu-jitsu if you don't understand it.
Yeah.
Like, if it doesn't, you know, if you don't get the game.
My father was always super busy working, you know, so like he was watching videos later, but like not.
What do you do for work?
He's a mechanic.
Oh, cool.
He's still working in Brazil, mechanic. And,
mechanic shop?
Yeah, yeah. Nice. He has a mechanic shop and work a lot.
Damn, you know that's cool.
But now he's more into it, you know what I mean? He's he's watching videos. He's sharing the Facebook.
Oh, really?
He says shit. Yeah. Really? Like, but back in the time, it was not too much, you know what I mean? He was like just walking. Maybe he was not thinking we're going to take that serious, you know? But
so even at 17, you knew jiu-jitsu was going to be your life.
Oh yeah, and 17. I started to do in college physical education because of jiu-jitsu. I was not trying to graduate then to work in academy or school or nothing. I was just like, I want everything that I learned that I want to apply to jiu-jitsu.
That's sweet.
To my training, to understand my body and about training and getting better in every aspect, you know.
Because college in Brazil is free.
No, it's not.
Oh,
well, we have some public ones free.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean? And but in Brazil, is different than here. Like the good ones, you need to pay.
Oh, okay.
It's particular, you know, you need to pay, and that's what I did. Like paid a lot of money. Like now thinking, I said, I'm glad the information that I got there. I apply a few things during my life, my training. You know what I mean? The friends that I made there, but in the end, I spent probably like $50,000, you know what I mean? That's the Brazil money there. Maybe a little bit more.
50,
for a waste 60 of time. You know what I mean? So, maybe I would like use that time like to train more, you know what I mean? Because I was having college from 7 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon. Every day for 5 years.
Damn.
You know what I mean? And then when it got done, that's when I started like to training full time, right? Training mornings, training like afternoon, training night. You know what I mean? Before that was like college. And then I have a 1 hour, 1 hour and a half to lift weights, some strength conditioning, teach four to eight, and go to training 8 to 10. That's it. That was my routine for years. You know?
Dang.
So like now sitting and thinking, I might not do the college.
Yeah, the college waste.
You know what I mean? Like for me, for what my life was going, I don't think it worked. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was a waste of time.
How old were you when you got your black belt?
21. I was 21 years old.
Holy fuck, that's crazy.
Yeah, 21 years old. 21.
So you've been training jiu-jitsu for 23 years. Like, how many surgeries total have you had?
Oh fuck, let me count here. I have my elbow, meniscus here, ACL here, and my fusion neck 4.
Whew. So 3 of those are a full year out.
Yeah. Oh, I know. I recorded pretty fast. You know what I mean? Like, the meniscus easy was like a month. My elbow, the doctor said, oh, you're going to be like 6 to 9 months off. Like in 4 months, I was competing the New York Open.
Oh, really?
You know what I mean? Like I was like 3 months off and 1 month training. I went to compete. And I fought JT Torres on the final. He beat me in the final that one by 2-0.
Dang.
Like, and then the ACL, I fought in the UFC with 7 months after.
Oof.
And the neck was a little, the fusion of the neck took me a little bit longer. I was probably like 6 months complete off. Start training and I started competing maybe like 9 months, 8 months.
So even during that 6 months, what kind of stuff did you do to keep your head in the game? Or what kind of stuff did you do mentally to stay
good? That was hard. Like, I'm not going to lie, you know what I mean? Because especially like doing jiu-jitsu for so long and being involved and training, being a black belt, I still going to the academy, but I couldn't do nothing, you know? So mm-hmm. sitting there watching, it was killing me. And then what I used was, I tried to use that time that was training to go to physical therapy, and most of the my injuries, I did the physical therapy for 2 times a day, you know what I mean? Damn. And then the rest of the time I was teaching or I was going and doing kind of workout for other part of my body, you know? Mm-hmm. If you're my ACL was doing like upper body. If my elbow, I was running. You know, I was doing mm-hmm. something, you know, to keep my mind busy. You know what I mean?
Just always working around it.
Yeah. What I could do, you know?
Because that's what it seems like you see all the time, especially teaching jiu-jitsu. People get hurt and they don't come back. They don't come to the academy. They don't work out. One little injury and it puts them out. Yeah. It gives them excuse.
I
see
like a lot of people break their nail and say, oh, here, I can't train. Blah, blah, blah.
Weeks.
You know,
Jax.
In the end, you need to want to be there, you know, you want mm-hmm. to be to the training. You mm-hmm. need to enjoy the process. Like I said, in the beginning when I started to training and helping teaching, people were paying me like $20 a month, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Something like that. And it was not even counting, you know what I mean?
You weren't even doing it for that.
Yeah,
obviously.
You know what I mean? Like, I was getting hurt, little injuries here and there, but like, I was enjoying the time to be on the mat. Some days I was training, some days I was not, some days I was just like helping. But I was, because I wanted to be there. You
yeah.
know what I mean? So that, I think that's important. Okay. I think that got missed a little bit during the, in a lot of place, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
People put too much pressure on themselves, like when they go training, or they want to be good, they want to, or they have excuse if they are not good,
mm-hmm.
just because they don't put the time in, you know what I mean?
Did you ever go through a phase where you just were like, I'm like a month, a couple weeks or longer, where you just didn't train?
Oh, yeah. I did it for a while.
Where you're just like, I just over it for a little bit. And then
over, but like, especially when you have had the injuries,
mm-hmm.
I was, oh, man, that's going to take too long, 6 months, or I'm going to take 1 month, like, just eating,
yeah.
you know what I mean? Like, sitting on the couch, and once you start to heal, and then, okay, now I need to do something, you know? Mm-hmm. I need to go and walk my upper body.
But that passion's always been there.
Yeah, yeah. I was still like watching. Like I said, I was teaching. That was around my mm-hmm. life. So I was on the academy every day and I was trying to see what I could do, you know. But I never had that, oh, I'm going to be done. I'm not going to do that anymore, you know. I'm going to start to look for a different job or whatever.
Yeah.
No.
I remember when, like, right when I got my brown belt, I tore my bicep and you just said, just keep coming and watching. So yeah. I'd show up every single practice yeah. and just watch. And probably that 2 years as a brown belt, majority of it was me watching, and that's what mm-hmm. made me have like the most growth.
You got good as fuck though
in those yeah. couple yeah. years, and I was out most of them, but yeah. I was just literally
watching. You start to understand more the game and start to kind of understand what the person was thinking, you know. You don't know what he was thinking because he was just doing the move, but I said, oh, I think I understand what he tried to do, you know. And watching all the good roles
mm-hmm.
and also start to teaching, start to go into the details, passing that to your students,
mm-hmm.
make you a better person, a better instructor, and your technique way better too, you know.
Yeah. It's funny, like I remember when you first got to the lab, I didn't even like jiu-jitsu. Like I was a striker, and like I was like just learning it just because I knew I had to. But I remember just like how far ahead of everybody at the lab you are, like mm-hmm. stepwise, and I didn't understand jiu-jitsu. Yeah. Really, like I didn't understand how the levels of it, but now it's funny, like been training it so consistent, like I'll go to the lab and I'll be like, oh, I get it a little bit, like yeah. still so fucking much, but I get a little bit of the of
what the best
what one. They're trying to do, like what they're capable, what they're
that's what I said to you the other day about you mm-hmm. you know, like you, I can see when you're rolling the things that you're doing, you know what you're doing now, you're not just like rushing or trying to get out there or panicking, like you understand more the game on the ground, and that's dangerous, you know,
yeah.
because you can surprise anyone there, you know what I mean? And like when I went to the lab first time, I knew it, like even like there's a lot of guys that are from jiu-jitsu, but most of the guys are like MMA guys
right.
with different backgrounds, wrestling, striking,
yeah.
And jiu-jitsu is not easy. It is hard. You need to think a lot,
mm-hmm.
you know, and a lot of people don't have the patience to do it. And then they make mistakes, you know, and sometimes like teaching little moves here and there, I see the frustration on the face of the people. I said, oh, fuck, I don't know why is that. You know what I mean? But it takes time. You know? And now you finally start to understand that. Same way Tim did before, and you now start to have... You still have like a journey ahead of you, but you're going to just be growing, you know?
Yeah. The little tips that you would teach me, like when you're on top of me, like how you're trying to hold me down and where to put my hand, where to frame, just like those little tips every time we roll, I feel like what really just evolved my game within the last couple years.
And that's another part I think people don't realize, you know, like having training partners better than you, if you are a smart athlete, you're going to pick it up things from them, you know what I mean? Even they beat you. And I mean, if they don't say nothing, you're going to just feeling, and if you're smart enough, you're going to say, yeah, I start to understand now. You know what I mean? And I think that's everywhere. And I mean, if you go against a wrestler, better wrestler than you, and after a while, you start to understand and getting better. Same thing in jiu-jitsu, same thing in the striking. So I think it's important have that cross training.
Fuck yeah.
That's be open-minded, you know? Be open-minded. That's important.
That's what, what was it? Because you moved to the lab, 6 years ago? And I think I was a few months before you.
Yeah, I think so.
And then I heard about your accolades, and I was a purple belt at the time, but I'm mainly around like Americans and American wrestling and just kind of scrappy jiu-jitsu, never really gi jiu-jitsu. And then when I got invited to the competition training, I was around you and a bunch of the Brazilian guys, and that was the first time I was around a bunch of Brazilians who, and I was like, man, these guys are talking about jiu-jitsu, and they're grown up adults, and they're talking about the little details here and there, and they're really thinking about jiu-jitsu, and that's all they're thinking about. I was like, man, this is fucking sweet. So that's what made me attracted to like you guys and wanting to learn from you guys, because you really lived and thought about jiu-jitsu. It wasn't just like, oh yeah, we're showing up, we're gonna do some triangles and arm bars and roll. It was pretty sweet.
Like I said, you need to put your time in that, you know, your mind, your body, and study. You need to study. Like, that's something that I was did when I was young in Brazil, you know what I mean? All my belts, blue, purple, brown, even when it's black. You went to the academy, someone did something with you that you were not expecting or don't know. You go back, talk to the guys studying, and try to understand. You know what I mean? Start to see that. And that's became a habit, you know? Mm-hmm. Like all the time you start to talk and try to make it be better for you. And the other hand, the other person is going to get better too. Because he's going to know now what you want to do to him. And he's going to like change it. So it's kind of like a evolution, you know?
Hell yeah.
Never stop.
Yeah, it's fucking sweet. So this last ADCC was the third ADCC you've competed in, I think, right?
Oh, the fifth.
Fifth ADCC?
Yeah. Ooh, what?
Are you serious?
Not counting the trials that I did in Brazil before. Holy I did trials in Brazil shit. Before. That's fine.
So that was your fifth. And you're 36 years old coming into this ADCC.
Now, yeah.
So you're probably the oldest competitor in your division.
I was.
The average age was 21 or 23.
There was 23 or 24, something like that.
So what was it in you that was like, I can win it this year and I'm going to train Harvard? The previous years, how come you had so much passion for this one? Like, I'm going to go try to fucking win this one.
Because I knew I didn't train for the other ones. You know what I mean? That was the big thing, you know what I mean? ADCC is one of the biggest tournaments, but I don't know, through the years, every time that I went to one ADCC, I got invited to do it, but I didn't put my time in the training.
Yeah, like hard training
I never invest on that. I was always like, or trying for some train that I had before, some camp, or had injuries, or blah, blah, blah. And you know what I mean? I was just went there because I didn't want to say no to them. Maybe they're not inviting me again. I say, well, fuck, I'll show up there and see what... But I was never a commitment to the training, and you know what I mean? And I did good in most of the years, you know what I mean? Like every single time that I lost there, I lost by decision. Nobody ever scored 1 point to me at DCC.
Damn,
that's fucking crazy.
Like in my division, you know? So like, but even that, like I felt the difference. You know what I mean? I was never like into to my training. And this time I thought, man, like I'm 36 years old, or I'm going to take this one serious. You know what I mean? And do the training that I've done before for the worlds with the gi or the worlds no gi that I want. Like my mind strong and my body and the trainings. Or fuck, I'm gonna lose again. You know what I mean? And, okay, I can try again in 2 years, but I'm gonna be 38. I don't know if I'm gonna want to pass for all that training again, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I decided, man, I'm going to pay the price right now. And win or lose, I know I'm going to get there in shape and no excuse, you know? No,
fuck yeah.
No, I don't have nothing to say. Like, not that people say to me or I go to people and give that excuse. It's not mm-hmm. about that. It's more with myself, you know what I mean? Inside my mind, I know, like, oh, fuck, like 2017, fuck, I didn't train because I was lazy to do strength condition. Or 2015, I just roll, you know what I mean? I didn't want to do this. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Like, every year I had some problems, but nobody knew it, but I knew it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So in 2019, I said, man, I'm going to do everything. Excuses. No excuses. And I go there. And that's exactly what happened. When I got the tournament, I was ready for anyone. All the 15 other guys, I didn't have any preference. I was not worried about bracket or nothing. I said, man, who comes, I'm ready. You know? Mm-hmm. Because I knew it. I trained really, really hard. Really hard. My strength condition, my trains. Sugar and you were there like all the time. You helped me too, you know. And it was like pushing myself to my limit, you know. Mm-hmm.
Fuck, that was sweet training. When we knew you were training for that, I was excited. I'm like, fuck yeah.
Well, that's why it's nice being around Tequila, because it's not like you're a specimen athlete. It's not like you're a freak athlete. John, you're just a normal white guy, but crazy white mind and a crazy work ethic, and it's cool to see.
Fuck, yeah, I think that's important. I mean, like, you need to, whatever you set for you, you need to be commitment to that and work as your ass off. If you're not, you know what I mean? There's someone somewhere in the world working more than you, mm-hmm. and he's going to beat you.
Mm-hmm. How did you develop that mindset? Like, who did you learn that from at a young age? Did you read it? Who did you learn it from? Where did you get it?
I think it was the experience, like, to get beat up, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And with my mistakes during the tournaments and the training in general, you know, like, it's just because I think there's no secrets. Like, you need to train. That's mm-hmm. it. You know what I mean? People can say a lot of things. Oh, these guys are, like you said, like, a crazy athlete. He's physically strong or he's smart. You know what I mean? Yeah, everything helps. But, like, if you don't put your time in there to train and push yourself, you're not going to win.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. You know what I mean? Like, who passing for that train, that phase of the train, knows what it is. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? You know what you need to open, you know what I mean? Like for NCC, like, my wife knows, like, how hard it was for me, you know what I mean? Because she was on my side all the time, waking up early, like, pushing my body, still teaching,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? Doing all that stuff. But, like, I was there every single practice, you know? I didn't skip one practice. Like, I was really, really good with my meals this time, you know? Cutting the weight in the right way.
Did that have a big advantage?
Like, huge? A big, huge for me, huge. That's another thing that, like, I just did for my MMA fights, mm-hmm. because I was going to 135 and it's a lot of weight. I said, fuck, I need to be commitment to my diet.
But, like, you walk around 170.
Yeah, I'm 170 right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for jiu-jitsu in general, I said, nah, I'll cut that later, you know?
Yeah.
Or don't worry, I'll find in the other division.
Yeah.
And so, wow, I still eating, like, shit before, mm-hmm. you know, and then after a while I said, okay, yeah, like, now it's professional, you know. It's not like that was in the, like, 90s, yeah. you know, 98 99, that fuck, you could do whatever. We need to take serious, you know. And
then how'd you hit up the Dr. Capago?
Yeah, I did through Lauren and Mike Hamill,
right? You message him?
Yeah, like, no, like, I talked to them first, mm-hmm. because I was watching their performance after I started to work with him, mm-hmm. and I felt they were a little bit better than before, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And I said, well, I trained those guys for, like, I don't know, 4 years, 5 years, mm-hmm. maybe, and I know a little bit about them and about the way their performance in the fights. And from the last fight, for that one that I saw, they had a big growing on the energy and the way that they're, like, performing. And I said, well, must be the dietitian, you know?
Fuck yeah.
And I said, well, let me give it a shot. Like, well, first I didn't want. My wife was like, Amanda, my wife was like, hey, let's get a nutrition for this camp. And I said, sweet. Oh, fuck, no, I don't want to. I don't want to, like, no. You know, I don't even know if we're going to make money then. Yeah. I mean, because you don't make money to ECC just if you win. I said, fuck. She said, no, you need to invest. You know what I mean? Like, might be your last one. Let's do it. And I said, no, I'm not doing it. And she said, I'm going to hide one for you.
Oh, like, that's cool.
In Brazil. Yeah. I don't care.
That's cool.
I said, okay, let me choose one first. And then I went to him because I know, like, Mike and Lauren. And I think it was the best thing that I did.
Hell yeah. Because he was there. I saw in the videos, too. He was there rehydrating you right after each match, right?
And that was another important aspect to my run on the ECC. Mm-hmm. Because he was supposed to not be there. He was supposed to be in Ireland for one of his athletes in the Bellator. Mm-hmm. But he lives in LA and the fight was in Anaheim, I think, mm-hmm. in California. So like a week before the tournament, he messaged me and said, hey, my guy got hurt. He's not fighting anymore. I'm going to be there. Fuck, so I'll be able to help you there. And I said, oh, fuck, sweet. That's good.
That's nice.
So, but I didn't know what to expect. You know, I was mm-hmm. following his diet during the 6 weeks. But right there, like, I never met him in person, so I don't know. Mm-hmm. It might be awkward or not. Yeah.
Did he stay in the room with you, too?
He was not. He was going to drive back and forth to his uh-huh. house, but I was 30, 40 minutes away. Mm-hmm. But when you got there, you know what I mean? Like, the weigh-ins in ATC is like 5:30 in the morning. And then he was helping me to during the whole day. And he was supposed to leave and drive back. Like in early in the morning, but mm-hmm. I told him, I'm like, stay here in the room, I don't have extra bed there. Nice. And he said, okay, cool, but I don't have clothes, so I gave one of my shirts to him to use.
Oh, perfect. You know what I
mean? So he was there like for 4 days.
Man,
so, that's sweet.
I bet that was huge, that especially huge. For 15 minute and 20 minute matches.
Yeah.
I didn't even know that was going to be a thing.
20 minute match. No, or 15 like, minutes with a meow.
Yeah, like all the match was like 15, beside the first one that I submit, around 8 minutes. But the final was 20 when could be potential 40. You know what I mean? Oof. Like that's what I was like training for my final be 40 minutes. Oof. Because in the history of ADCC, if you see like especially my division, the final always go to the second overtime. And ADCC like 10 minutes no points in the final. Mm-hmm. 10 minutes points. And then if nobody score points, you have 10 minutes first overtime. And more 10 minutes second overtime. So that's 40 minutes. And most of the finals go to 40 minutes.
Yeah.
Or at least 30. So I always count to, oh man, if I am going to do 40.
That's fucking sweet.
You know what I mean? That's how I train for.
40 minutes.
For a that's match, yeah.
Badass.
Man, yeah. And that with Cobrinha's son too in the finals. Oh, that was so such a cool sick. Moment too.
I think woo! I was sharing the top of the cake, you know?
Oh, yeah.
That was so
it
sweet.
Was, dude. Especially the timing too. When you jumped on his back and got both hooks, yeah. I was like, oh my yeah. god, that was
well.
Nuts.
Like, I like the guy who was like doing the comment on the
commentary
on the flow grappling.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Like, because he kind of understood a little bit what I was thinking there on the fight.
Mm-hmm.
Because he said, "Oh, Tank, he's not attacking much. The other guy, the Kennedy, started to attack a little bit more." But like, I was shutting down every aspect that he was trying to do, and it was mm-hmm. like making him tired. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it was open up. I was still moving, fainting here and there, but like was just picking my shot. I'm not going to be like a crazy for 20 minutes shooting,
fucking
shooting.
Experience.
Right exactly. Like, yeah. I'm going to get tired. You know what I mean? Even I trained for not get tired, but like you can make a mistake. Mm-hmm. One of yeah. those scrambles, he's in your back and that's it. Or get a corner guillotine. The level's that high, you know? So okay. I was just like waiting. And I knew he was like younger. He's like first or second year as a black belt. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
He's hungry. Fuck.
He's hungry. He's like Cobrinha's son. He knew it like had a little bit of pressure over him too, you know? Mm-hmm. He was trying to like deliver that. Show that, okay, yeah. I'm here to take over now.
Yeah.
So I knew he was trying to intimidate me. And I said, well, we're going to see. Yeah, we'll see.
Man, that
God,
was
I loved
nice.
When you had Keith Kerkorian in the head and arm. Yeah. I was in the when they were commentating. I was yeah. literally
was
in bed laughing.
Me too.
I was like,
me too.
He's like, gonna yeah. fucking get out of that. I was me like, too. I've yeah. been there. You ain't getting out.
Yeah,
you ain't getting out.
Yeah, that was good.
He said, Tank looked like he's getting tired or something. Said something like that. I'm like, piss motherfucker. But I think that guy was one of his
yeah train partners, whatever. Well,
that makes sense. It's a little biased, but it's just
exactly.
Yeah, I don't see him tapping out to yeah. this. No way. 5 seconds later,
you don't tap to anyone in the academy. And the oh, next thing that you see, he's like,
I loved it. I
loved it's different. I mean, that is different level difference. You know what I mean? But it is what it is.
And well, if they haven't felt power like you on top of them, then they don't know either.
Well, dude, that's like you can't just go to any gym and feel that. No, you have to go like.
Yeah, but like I said, like. Different some athletes have different like qualities, you know. Uh-huh. Like I know I'm on top of someone, it's gonna be hard. I mean, I have a lot of pressure, a lot of experience, a lot of controls, you know what I mean? So it's different than like a 200 pound be on top of you, but he don't know how to hold you. You know what I mean? You might get out and don't feel the same pressure, you know? So like, you need to, like, each athlete has like a different quality that he's going to bring you to the train or to the fight. And then the only way sometimes to you exactly know that is feeling.
Right. You know what I mean? Totally.
Yeah. And then that was such a huge detail for you too, Sean. Now, because before you wouldn't want to go with bigger people. You'd get pissed. Like, this person's bigger than me. I don't want to get fucking crushed.
Yeah.
Now these big guys are having a hard time even getting close to you. Yeah.
Well, even going into my match with like Gomi and Gilbert Melendez, I'm like, I just, even if these dudes get on top, they're not going to feel like you. Like, I really felt like, I'm like, they're just, like, that's a different level of pressure.
But that's one of the beauty of the jiu-jitsu, you know what I mean? Give you the chance to experience that and the confidence, you know what I mean? Like like you, I started training, I was like smaller too, you know what I mean? Like now I'm on 170, like eating a lot, but like, but I was like 60, 50s, 40 something, like when I was younger, and I was one of the smallest on the academy. You know what I mean? So everyone that was rolling was bigger than me. I was like, oh, fuck, there you go. So you need to like develop that strength, that technique, and understand, and little by little start to gain the confidence. And, well, I can manage that guy, no matter his weight. He's 180, 190, 200. You know what I mean? So that's probably what we were like seeing then. They said, well, like the big is strong, but like I pass with things way harder before, you know? So, but if it never happened with you, probably would get that and say, like, fuck, that's going to be hard.
Yeah.
And like even going into like my next fight with Jose Quinones, I'm like there's no way he's going to get on top of me and I'm not going to be able to get up. Mm-hmm. Like, just, that's not going to. Yeah,
like, I mean, I don't see that guy beating you like anywhere. Yeah. I mean, like,
it's sweet because you'll be in my corner. Tim will be in my corner. It's like, and then I'll have Brandon excited. In my corner.
You're gonna be a good night.
Yeah, Brandon asked me, he's like, "Hey, so like, what do I do?" I was like, "Just don't say anything." He just he's like, "All right, I got it."
Yeah, I'll make sure.
Good.
Yeah, I'll just pretty good. Make sure to tell him. No, but I told him, I'm like, Tim and Tank, if they see something, they'll tell me. You don't need to say shit. He was like, "Fuck yeah!" I didn't hoping I said that. I think. Yeah, like, good. But it was good. He asked. But no, yeah, it's going to be a scary corner right there. It's going to be sweet.
It'll be nice, too, just because no one's seen, like, Sugar 2.0. Yeah, everyone sees Sugar on the fucking the Contender Series.
Oh, God.
The young little like kid. Yeah.
even the Quinte that he did, you know what I mean? Like, he fought, like, super experienced guys, MMA, like Gomi and Gilbert. And, man, like, he crushed the guys. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, that's how you see how his jiu-jitsu level got there. It's not even talk about the striking, his new tricks, his footwork, or, you know, his strength. So, it's...
Yeah, it'll be over two years since I fought. So, anybody that goes to watch even my last fight, it's like, that's even a different person.
Mm-hmm. That's fun how in 2 years you change, right? Like,
it's been crazy.
Yeah.
And it's been... Jiu-jitsu and lifting with Brandon. Yeah. It's like, and those, like, the lifting with Brandon's made my jiu-jitsu even way more better, too.
And you're pretty, like, a smart kid. You're pretty good at watching something and doing it. But just having you to train with and having that confidence in our mind, that's something you can't, people don't get. Training with you and the level you are and getting that confidence just from that is fucking huge.
Dude, that's huge.
Yeah.
I'm so fucking lucky, like that we get to train with you. Because, like I said, no one's gonna be on top of me that you'll feel heavier.
Yeah, not just that, like heavier, but even the technique. You know what I mean? I don't see anyone like surprising you with something that you never seen before.
Right.
You're passing the training, or you're not even starting your camp yet. You know what I mean?
Right.
So during the camp, you're gonna grow even more. Right. You know what I mean? Because all your attention is gonna be there. You're gonna be like even more healthy, not eating bad or whatever. You know what I mean? So it's when that's happening there, I don't see how those guys there, for what I seen them, like, I'm not just talk about Jose will fight, right? But like, I don't see anyone in the 135 division on the UFC able to surprise you on the ground at all.
That's sweet.
You know what I mean? That's true, man.
Nice too, because the techniques that we learn from you, we don't have to question them in our mind. I'm like, that maybe works for you, but it's not work for me.
Like
whatever
works.
You tell us, we take it in and say, that's the answer.
That
and
works.
We're going to do that 100%. Compared to some other places, it's like, well, was he really sure when he taught me that? Or, you know.
Well, like anywhere, you're going to adapt in things here and there, but the concept is going to be there. Mm-hmm. That's the big thing. You know? You guys are good on that. Get the concept. If you need to adjust one little piece here and there, you guys gonna do it, you know what I mean? For what you guys need. But the most important is understand the concept. Understand the concept on the ground. Like why this? Why that? Why is that's the time or whatever? Mm-hmm. That's what make you guys grow and be ready for anyone. You
yeah.
know what I mean?
So, especially the jiu-jitsu too. The one thing that helped me so much is those 10-minute rounds. Not thinking about the time. Not thinking about getting tired. In jiu-jitsu, you can't be thinking about getting tired all the time because you have to be so focused on advantage point or the points or how much time is left and just focus on all those details. I think that helped a lot too.
Yeah. I remember when we started training at Fabiano's, when we would do all those rounds and like you'd be walking around, everyone would be tired, and I was looking at, I'm like, and I would gas the fuck out, my forearms I can't even grab, and I'm like, I know I can get to that mindset to where I'm walking around on the mat, like who else wants to go,
everybody like lying down and just
like I craved that. And I've slowly built up to that, but it's physical. Obviously, your body has to be, but it's a mindset.
It's a mindset. It's like, yeah, that I say. Like, that's something that I did a lot through my during my career. A lot of people say, "Man, you're not tired, man. You don't look tired." But like, I'm fucking tired as shit. But like, my mind make me not show that I'm tired. You know what I mean? Like, I'm tired and breathe and try to get like the 10 seconds that I have, or 15 seconds, or 1 minute left just to recover to the next one. You know what I mean? So. It's a lot of the mindset and build your strength in your mind, you know?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
That's been
especially like when, you know what I mean? When you're inside there in the mats or in the cage, you know what I mean? Like, it's a lot of emotions, a lot of things could happen, you know what I mean? And it's easy to break your mind.
Yeah.
If you break your mind, you're done, you know what I mean? You're going to make a mistake or whatever. The guy's going to beat the hell out of you. But like, if you keep your mind strong, yeah. Nothing's gonna break you.
Right. Especially a high level fighting, man. You show you're tired or you're hurt a little bit, that's just gonna be a red flag. So how important it is, even if you're fucking gassed out, is just to fake it.
Fuck yeah.
That's true.
It's nice when you see someone gassed out a little bit.
Oh yeah, that's
because then you get a little energy. Yeah. It's like, where did that energy come from? Like, oh, put it on a little
more. You can see in the eyes. I'm like, oh, he got tired. There you go.
So what? Who do you got Saturday, Connor or Cowboy, Sean?
I got Connor. Just, it's funny. I was doing a talkie video today. Someone asked me who I got. I'm like, Connor McGregor will make. He could be fighting fucking anybody in the world. He'll make you think he's gonna win. Like, oh, he's the best in the world at that. But he's the best in the world at that because he feels that. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I can relate in a similar way to that. Where I'm like, I feel like Connor's gonna win, but he made me also think he was gonna beat Khabib too.
Yeah.
But I got Connor.
Yeah, I got Connor too. I think he's gonna come, you know what I mean? Like, especially the way that he lost the other one, and he probably did the homework, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
To be there in his best and have a good performance.
Yeah.
Who you got?
Especially, I think a striker right now with Connor in those 4-ounce gloves.
Yeah.
He's gonna touch him.
And he's saying he's sitting. Did you watch the press conferences or any of the interviews?
No, I didn't.
Oh, he's like talking how he's sitting down on punches a little. He's understanding a little bit more of his striking, which is. And it's about accuracy. A lot of people don't understand how important accuracy is. Like he's not gonna punch Cowboy right here. Mm-hmm. He's gonna hit him on the chin. Yeah. And one if you shot, can hit like, someone on this chin like that, that's where you get knocked. That's how he knocked out Aldo. So I feel like that could be it.
Especially a Cowboy, the way he kind of stands there in a more of a Muay Thai stance, and Connor bounces, boom, like a fast. I'd take Connor by TKO second round.
That'd be sweet.
Yeah, I got first round.
The press conference was weird. First round. Press conference was weird. It's like they're like, no, you like, it's like you're gonna win.
They're
just being really good friends, like, which was cool, super respectful, which was cool. I liked that, but
it's making fun. That money would be respectful.
Cowboy kept thanking Connor, like, thank you.
I think I read something on Twitter saying like Connor say, hey, welcome, Donald.
You're welcome. He did. He said that at the press conference. You're
multimillionaire. Well, think of the old press conferences too, where everyone's like, "Oh, shut up, you little Irishman. I'll teach you." And now Cowboy's like thanking Connor, like, "You're the man."
And he said, "He's like, he's done everything he said he's gonna done. How do you not respect that?"
Oh fuck yeah!
But it is fun when Connor's being a fucking drunk freak, just screaming like that's what I tuned in for. But that's okay.
Yeah, for sure.
That's funny.
What are we at, Jesus? That's perfect.
Fuck yeah.
All right, brother. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Valleywide Glass, for sponsoring us. Peace.
Doses.